Hey everybody, welcome back to Up the Vibe. And today I'm joined by previous guest Gary Osborne and also Dr. Manu Seisvadei, who has
Hi,
authored
Joe.
a book on the architecture of the Great Pyramid and published several papers together with Robert Schock and Robert Bavall. We'll be continuing our discussion from last time on deciphering the so-called Penison Code that was received by Jim Penison when he touched the unknown craft during the Rendlesham UFO incident. We will then be focusing on potential connections with the code and Atlantis. How are you both?
Fine,
Good,
thanks.
Thanks.
Good to be here.
Thank you for taking the time to be on here. It's going to be really exciting to hear more about this these connections and this incident. So I thought we'd start a little bit with a recap from last time. It was before Christmas. So it was a little while ago that we spoke, Gary. And when we spoke, we started off by looking at what the code showed in terms of the coordinate system, and then moved on to more focusing on the Giza Plateau and then the connections that you had discovered to the fine structure constant to a very high degree of accuracy.
Yeah, it was really showing how the code authenticates itself. You know, all the kind of step-by-step discoveries I was making up to that point. And it really only came together in 2018 when the latest determination of the fine structure constant came up. And I knew then that the code had authenticated itself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just want to say something about mathematics, because this is how it's proven, the code. It uses, whoever devised the code uses mathematics. And that's as objective as you can get. You know, it goes above and beyond all our kind of emotionally attached or driven kind of beliefs, views and opinions. So something like this, it had to be proven with mathematics. You can't refute mathematics. You can't argue with it. 2 times 2 equals 4. You can't argue with that. So it's as clear as that. And I've become kind of weary of the UFO, UAP phenomenon in general. You know, and for me, this is what's important, because it's proven contact with it demonstrates retrocausality. At the same time, it authenticates itself. It's a demonstration of retrocausality, that information is being sent back to the past that has an effect on the present, which was in 2018 when that number came up, and perhaps into the future as well. So, to me, it's like the jewel in the crown of message authentication,
mm-hmm.
and it's proof of contact. And if it's proof, it's authenticated itself, then that means that something unusual and phenomenal happened at Rendlesham in 1919. So it proves that as well. To me, it does.
Yeah. And Manu, do you want to step in and talk a little bit about the code, how it gets the fine structure constant, and your kind of history in discovering this?
Yeah, I've learned all of it from Gary. I didn't know anything about the Penison Code until a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And then Gary brought me up to speed. So I'm coming at this from an outside observer, with some initiation because of Gary. I think this is a very interesting piece of ufology. To me, this is special because it's a communication. It's an alleged communication. There is a good provenance to this message, because it comes from a credible source, Jim Penniston, who, so at face value, at least, it should make you stop and take a look at it and consider it, no matter how plausible you might think it is. And then what Gary just alluded to is an important piece of this mystery, because the code, in Gary's interpretation, proves to the audience, to us, that it is real. And the way it does it is almost, it's one of the few ways that you could do this unmistakably, which is by predicting the future. The code says it comes from the future, and it actually predicts something that hadn't happened in 1980, that was not going to happen until 2018. And it uses an ingenious way, as Gary has discovered, to demonstrate its knowledge of the future. And that has to do with the fine structure constant. It maps the fine structure constant onto the second pyramid. It basically mm-hmm. maps two megalithic dials onto the Giza Plateau. One is the values of the fine structure constant expressed as latitudes, and the other is a famous line at Giza. It's called the Giza Diagonal, described by Egyptologists years ago, and that is a timeline. And the way that time is being mapped by this code is, according to Gary's interpretation, has to do with precession. Both of these pieces of information are not explicitly mentioned in the code. They are implicitly encoded in the code. And there's a good reason for that. And Gary also just alluded to that. And it has to do with the causality problem. So if you send a message from the future into the past, you can't change the past materially because you would potentially obviate the very future from which you generated that message. Mm-hmm. And so the way that Gary has pieced this together, and my also understanding is that the code does this in a completely different way, in sort of a quantum mechanical way, by manipulating probabilistic outcomes, not the outcome itself in a deterministic way, but the outcome in a probabilistic way, which is what quantum mechanics, after all, is all about. And so what it does, it helps the observer to make a certain discovery by giving clues, but it's not 100% necessity outcome because the observer also has to be knowledgeable. So Gary is one of the world's expert on mm-hmm. Giza metrology, on Giza mathematics, on the dimensions. And so it does take someone who is familiar with the numbers, with some, you know, special numbers that everybody who's in alternative history, for example, will recognize that Giza has always been associated with pi and phi, the qubit, certain numbers, right? So it requires someone like that who's alerted when they see certain numbers. And that's what the code, the way I see it, plays on. It plays on familiarity with certain numbers. And then it takes you there in relatively few steps. And there's confirmation on several levels. And that's why when it gets complicated, but at the end of the day, what it means is that it's double and triple stitched, that according to how Gary interprets this. So it overcomes the plausibility problem that the code has. Obviously, people are going to look at this and saying, this is hard to believe. This is, first, you're saying that this is a message from another intelligence, and then you're saying it comes from the future. So these are two huge barriers to believability. Mm-hmm. And in the way that Gary pieced this together, if the code was made in the future, whoever made the code knew that this was going to be a problem and had to overcome all these problems. So it's an ingenious solution. If it's a real code, okay. It's absolutely brilliant the way it was done. This is my observation so far from what I've learned from Gary.
Yeah, it's it helps in a way because I think when I started talking to Gary about the code in the last podcast, I did mention why is it not something more easy for us to discern a message. Yes. You know, who I am or who the being was or where they're from, what year and everything. And maybe what you're saying kind of makes sense in the way that if they'd sent that message, is the likelihood is that they would have changed the past and it would not have led to the future that they were from. It may have led to a future, but not the future that they were from. And yes. That itself would have meant that, well, it was kind of self-defeating in a way.
Yes. So, of course, you could come say, well, Manu, if you're saying that the code is not being explicit, then how do you know that your interpretation is correct? And of course, my first answer is, I don't know. I'm not the code expert. Gary is the code expert. Mm-hmm. And others have to judge if they can reproduce the same steps when they're being alerted to it. But my personal impression is that what this code has done is to confirm the observer's suspicions of certain probable outcomes, right? So there's obviously a host of probable meanings that someone could come up with, but the code takes you down a decision tree, so to speak, right? You start at the top and you have all these possible explanations, and then you come up, you lean towards one explanation, and then that explanation gets confirmed and triple confirmed. And that is what impressed me in terms of what Gary has shown. Yeah. So there's several self-reinforcing pieces of evidence that come out of this code. And one of those things is the processional numbers.
And is there any aspect to the code or the thinking, the logic behind it, that there was a moment in which your kind of a belief in it turned and was like, oh, yeah, this is definitely something, this goes on to something? Was there a moment, was there a particular aspect to the code that, or the calculation that did that?
Yeah. So, yes, that's a great question. So I come at this from a science. When you are a pure scientist, like, you know, you're not in applied science, but you are in basic science, which is my background. Plausibility is not a standard of proof. If the model can explain the observations, the reproducible observations, then that's a valid scientific model until it's falsified by experiments, by experimental outcomes that the model predicts. So this is how you do science. So to me, when I do not use plausibility to evaluate a model. And the nice thing about the model that Gary's proposed is that it does make at the time what you were just asking me, when I decided, yes, this is something potentially real, is when the model made a testable prediction. At that point, Gary had taken this to its end, to one of its possible ends. And I said, look, people, it doesn't matter if you think this is real, not real. At the end of the day, the code is saying, look, here's point X, take a look at that. And that will confirm or not if the code is real or not. Mm-hmm. So in this particular case, what we'll talk about in a few minutes, it's the Sphinx. And I actually came at this from exactly the same logic. I, from my own research with Robert Schock and with Robert Bouval and also Graham Hancock. So we're all converging on the same prediction that there is something under the Sphinx. And it's an easy experiment to do. And if all of the evidence that we've looked at are correct, if that model that we're proposing is correct, then there should be something under the Sphinx. And so it's a test. It makes a testable prediction. Now, the problem is that people who are not in science and they start arguing with you, they don't understand that this is normal business for scientists. We come up with models all the time, and these models may be plausible, they may be implausible. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter. As if the model explains, if the model explains all the observation and it competes with other models, then the way you vet these models is by doing an experiment. That's all we want. We just want to do an experiment and falsify or confirm. So the answer to your question is yes. When I realized that Gary is actually making a prediction that you can test, I realized that he is just acting like a regular scientist. He looked at the observation. He took it to one of its potential logical ends, and he made a testable prediction from it. And this is what scientists do every single day.
Okay. And to Gary, I've been thinking a little bit about the calculations and thinking, was there potentially, and I'm thinking also about a previous podcast with Jimmy Planchette, who said that in some way he felt influenced. And I don't know if we talked about this maybe before, but do you feel like some of the calculations came to you from some sort of external influence, or did they come to you kind of quite naturally just through studying it?
Quite naturally, really, I would say. Yeah. I think it's kind of like a balance between rationality and intuition, you know, because a lot of it is intuitive. A lot of the step-by-step, the process that I was showing you in those slides on the last interview, it's intuitive, you know. What I was going to say is the code uses the fine structure constant to authenticate itself. You know, you don't have to know about the fine structure constant to know about this number, because it's the number that's important. It's a 12-digit number, you know, 9-decimal-place number. But that number was only determined in 2018. And the strange thing about the code is that I needed a lot of tools and programs, and especially the mapping data, the survey mapping data of Giza, the latest survey maps, which were determined by Glenn Dash the Glenn Dash Foundation, his team. And that only really concluded in 2018, which is the same year when this fine structure constant number was determined by physicists. Mm-hmm. So it's like 2018 was kind of like a pivotal year. You got 1980 when the code originated, and you got 2018. And it's in the code. I mean, what all the coordinates lead to, especially the Giza coordinates, the Nazca coordinates to Giza, leads to this fine structure constant number, which is it's provided by this, you know, the golden cut latitude. Mm-hmm. So it's used in a really ingenious way. It's using the Plateau of Giza to communicate this number, to provide, like, predict this number using a latitude running through Giza, which actually divides the distance between G1, Great Pyramid in the north, and G3 in the south, into the phi ratio proportions of 1 and 0.618. So that in itself, the phi ratio thing with Giza, I mean, that it's in itself is kind of like a major discovery anyway, and that came from the code. Mm-hmm. But to then find that the numbers in that latitude in 1980 generates the inverse number of the fine structure constant, which is one of the most mysterious numbers in physics, that just, and it's the way it authenticates itself, and it's also a demonstration of retrocausality. It's beyond coincidence, you know.
So what do you think the purpose of the message was to both of you? What do you think the ultimate purpose was? Was it to first to discover something new, or just to authenticate itself and say we're here?
No. Yeah, I was going to say that's the way it authenticates itself, using the fine structure constant. What the fine structure constant is, let me read this out, because this is what Manu sent me, and he's right. According to the late astronomer Carl Sagan, the number 137 and the number of decimals following it is the quintessential candidate for the crown jewel of interstellar message authentication, because knowledge of it presupposes a state of technology which allows a civilization to measure it. The more accurate the number is in terms of the number of decimals after 137, the more advanced the civilization. Thus, the string of numbers after the period, decimal point, following the number 137 becomes a measure of the level of knowledge and intelligence. Okay, so we're talking about a 12-digit number. Mm-hmm. And it's the full number that was determined by physicists in 2018. The last three numbers are they're probabilistic. They're within range, put it that way, the last three numbers, like 084. But the full number that was actually published in 2019, it was determined in 2018, but published in 2019. This 13-digit, this 12-digit number. So you can't get more detailed than that. You know what I'm saying? Something that's just, it authenticated itself. And the thing is that the timing of it, because I found this in 2019, when I was writing the last chapter of the book, I was writing with Jim Peniston.
Yep.
And I was relying on the previous determination, which was in 2014. And the last three digits of that number was 139. And I was relying on that first of all. I was writing about this, about how the code, you know, generates the fine structure constant. But as I said, I was relying on the previous determination. So as I was writing this last chapter and writing this all up, I thought, I wonder if the new determination has been published yet. And this was in May, I think it was May 28th, that I thought of looking to see on the internet to see if the new determination had come up. And the new, I found that on Wikipedia, they published it, and it was the number, the full 12-digit number that the latitude, the golden cut latitude generates. And so the last three digits were the same as what the latitude generates.
Mm-hmm.
So with this new
determination. That was kind of a special moment for you, that kind of a confirmation moment. Yeah.
Yeah. So I decided to look on Wikipedia, well, on the internet to find it, to see if the new determination had come up. That was on the 28th, but the new determination had only just been published on the 26th of May, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I thought the timing of all this, it's that you factor that into it as well. It's phenomenal. It's incredible. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I knew then that the coder will authenticate itself, and it could only do so. This is the other thing, is that in the whole timeline of human history, 1980 was the only year that this demonstration of retrocausality could have been implemented, you know? So
yeah, mind blowing
as well. I mean, I think Manu will tell you more about that as well.
Yeah, yeah. So what's your take on what the message is trying to say?
Yeah, so my understanding is so far the code has accomplished three things, and there may be more, but those three things is A, proof that I am a real message. B, establish that time it has something to do with time, and that is expressed through precession. So there's a fine structure constant dial, megalithic dial. There's a time megalithic dial, and C, to send you to two places, the Sphinx and the Azores. This is so far what the code is telling Gary.
Okay.
In order to get to these three places, you have to first learn how the code talks to you. So I want to just add to something that Gary was just saying. So the code does not mention 137. It does not mention the fine structure constant. So people might say, well, how do you know that the code is using the fine structure constant to authenticate itself, right? And so here is how it works. It sends you to places in Giza where 137 is actually an important number. First of all, the Sphinx, the core body of the Sphinx is 137 cubits long. And we know this from Mark Lehner's survey of the Sphinx in the 80s. So this is fairly well known, but it's not known to everyone. You know, if you ask most alternative history researchers, most Egyptologists, they will not be able to tell you how long the Sphinx is, but it is out in the literature. So it's something that you have to dig up. The second thing is you can fit the Sphinx 12 times around the pyramid of Khafre. So, and 137 is a prime number. So this is an interesting kind of a dilemma. How did the ancient Egyptians choose to make the pyramid of Khafre 411 cubits on the base, which is 3 times 137. So 137 sticks out at Giza.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how the code does it, right? It doesn't say 137. It sends you by using coordinates, by using lines, and the length of these lines they themselves have certain numerical significances. It sends you to these places, and then boom, you see the number come up, 137. You see, 137, that's the fine structure constant. So what does it want me to do with that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now it takes you to the next step. Well, it wants you to fine structure the fine structure constant, meaning it is saying, I know the decimal structure of the constant to 8 significant digits. I knew that to 9 decimal places. I knew that in 1980, what it would be in 2018. So how does it do that? By basically, as you can probably imagine, when you're dealing with 9 decimal places, 8 decimal places, you're talking about tiny little differences, right? So if the code wants to make a point, you have to magnify the scale so that even a tiny step, like 1/10 millionth of a decimal, becomes a large distance on your dial. And that's exactly what the code does. It sends you to the Khafre pyramid on the baseline, and this is what Gary has shown. And with these latitudes that convert to the fine structure constant values with a conversion factor, you suddenly have this magnified dial where these tiny little differences become very significant. So to give you an idea, in 1979, the known value of the fine structure constant in 1980, apologize. In 1980, 4 months before Boxing Day, before the Rendlesham Force incidents occurred, the known value at that point is 17 meters away from the line that Gary's reporting. 17 meters, even though in terms of decimals, we're talking about a tiny little difference between the values.
Mm-hmm.
To finish this, in order to know what this code was supposed to tell you, is you have to first learn the language of the code. you have to first understand how the code is communicating. And this is the most important thing. And Gary, I think, has done that. He's shown that the code talks to you indirectly. And that is because of the causality paradox. Once you figure that out, that it teaches you implicitly, then you go with the those implicit implications, if you will, and then it'll take you to the places. So what we know right now is it wants to take you to the Sphinx, and it wants to take you to the Azores.
Okay. Yeah, and talking about the Azores, shall we dive a bit more into that? Because I think this is a new topic that we didn't touch on last time. Does that sound sound good?
This is what we were going to go into next.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You see, there's several different themes that come out of the code. Mm-hmm. This kind of connection between the Sphinx and the Azores is just one of them.
Yeah.
Because another theme is the Giza diagonal processional timeline. It points to that as well. Mm-hmm. But we won't go into that yet. Yeah, what I found was, and this is after the mapping data was available, you know, mm-hmm. the accurate mapping data that Glenn Dash and his team provided. Some of it was in 2015, and I think it was all concluded in 2018. But for a code that originated in 1980, and that you would have to use these tools that only became available, fully available in 2018, that in itself is a, you know, paradox. Mm-hmm. So, I found that where the Giza coordinates are, the location of the Giza coordinates from the code that were found in the code, it's located between the two large pyramids, G1 and G2, you know, or Khufu and Khafre.
Is it worth bringing up the slide that you sent before? Is this a good opportunity?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Let me try and bring those up.
Yeah. I think it's the number 16, is it? I think.
Yeah, you tell me if I've got the right one.
Yeah.
Number 16 is this one. Can you see that?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So when you look at that, you think it's a kind of, what is that telling us? You know, you think that if there was coordinates for Giza, it would probably appear at the center of the Great Pyramid or the Sphinx. But that seems to be a nondescript location, you see? Mm-hmm. Now, I think in the next one, you'll see that it's not a nondescript location. It's very specific, actually, and giving us a lot of different information. Yeah, that's the second one. You see, it's the location of the Giza coordinates found in the code are on that line that's from the central north base of G2 to the central part of the west base of G1. Yeah.
Okay.
So you can see that, yeah?
So pen is the location where that was given in the code. This is okay. Yeah.
Yeah. It's on that line, you know,
to anyone, actually anyone who is who's familiar with Selim Hassan, Joe, this is a very significant spot because Selim Hassan was trying to interpret the meaning of the Sphinx. And he proposed that the Sphinx is sort of a marker, a solstice marker, a sunset marker between the two mountains of the two pyramids. And so that position is basically where the summer solstice sunset occurs between the two pyramids. And Selim Hassan talked about the symbolic meaning of that. So this is highly significant. Mm-hmm. If you're familiar even just a little bit with symbolic Egyptology that has to do with the sun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, okay. So I think the next slide might give you a bit more information on that. Yeah, so what I did was I actually determined this point, the actual midpoint between the two pyramids there. And I thought, well, you know, this is an intuitive kind of step that I took. It seems that you need to draw a line from the location of the Giza coordinates to that point center, you know, that midpoint between the pyramids.
Yeah.
You see? I think that shows up in the next one. Yeah, so, and then I extended it, and it goes all the way to the Sphinx.
Yeah.
But the target area on the Sphinx is, it's not at the mid part of the body or on the head. It's just at the part where the Sphinx, where the left forepaw meets the shoulder. Okay. Now, it was only later that I discovered through reading Manu's book, which is called Under the Sphinx, and I'll show you that there. Can you see that?
Yeah, I'm not sure if it's on the if the people can see it that are watching the video because I'm sharing screen, but hopefully they can.
Okay, yeah.
That's okay. Well, anyway. That's okay, Gary. That's okay. It's not that important right now. So just you talk about anomaly B, right?
Yeah, anomaly B, which was found by Dr. Robert Schock and Dr. Thomas Debecki in 1991. They used refraction tomography scanning, and they were able to determine that there was a void region just under the left forepaw of the Sphinx. It's they noticed these voids. There was anomaly A, which is at the front of the paw, and anomaly B, which is on the shoulder area.
Mm-hmm.
So it was after reading Manu's book in 2021, because he made a copy available to me, that I discovered now this is what the Giza coordinates are pointing to. And the reason why I know it's pointing to the Sphinx is because it's using a measurement, a distance, that you can, it provides us with three processional numbers. You know, it uses the British Imperial system, measuring system. It gives us feet, inches, and yards in the same distance. You know, if you, I think it's 2160 feet, which you multiply by 12, you get 25920 inches. And if you divide by 3, you get 720. And those are all processional numbers. So I knew that was beyond a coincidence, that it points to that void region called anomaly B, you know, just where the shoulder.
Gary, I'm sorry, just to make this a little bit more visual, Joe, just imagine the zodiac constellations. There's 12.
Mm-hmm.
Each one of them, on average, it takes 2160 years for the at the rate of precession. And then if you can divide each house of the zodiac into four quadrants, then each one of those quadrants will be 540. So I just wanted to, those numbers are all precessional
Graham Hancock talks a lot about the precession of the equinox, and that's these numbers coming up there. Just to ask, this number this line that where the yellow line joins, is this the golden cut number? Is that the golden cut?
No, I've got nothing to do. This has got nothing to do with the golden cut. I just want to make it clear that the golden cut latitude and the fine structure constant that it generates, that is how the code authenticates itself. And then after you know that it authenticates itself, has proven itself, then you can find all these other things in the code. And this is just one of them. It's just one of the themes of several that come up that is telling you something. And it's proven it all through mathematics. So, that yellow line, as I said, it's okay. That yellow line is, as I said, it's a specific distance that gives you three processional numbers. So you know that it's about precession, and you know that this is beyond coincidence, that it was intended. And so when I read Manu's book, I knew then what it was pointing to. It's pointing to this void region under the left forepaw of the Sphinx, called anomaly, which they referred to as anomaly B. And I thought, that's got to be it. And I discussed this with Manu. I mean, Manu and I met up in 2018, and this book came out in 2021. And it was only then that I realized what this was pointing to, what the Giza coordinates are pointing to. So, but you see that heading line. It's a heading line, okay? That yellow line is a heading line. And it's at a specific degree in azimuth degrees. It's 115.41 degrees azimuth. And if you take that heading line and you go in the opposite direction, the same heading line, but you add 180 degrees because it's in the opposite direction, it will give you 295.41 degrees. And that goes all the way. You find that the cursor, if you use Google Earth, the cursor will take you on that heading line all the way to São Miguel in the Atlantic, which is one of the islands of the Azores. That island, São Miguel, is only 290 square miles in an ocean that's 14.1 million square miles. So it's like a needle in a haystack. So you can see that all this, the way it all matches up, you know, it was intentional. It's not something that is, okay. It goes beyond coincidence.
Is there another slide just to demonstrate that?
Yeah, or? I think the next slide is where, yeah, that's the
that's about the void,
refraction tomography scan that Robert Schock and Thomas DeBakey had.
Okay.
They were saying they would be able to determine the anomaly A and anomaly B under the Sphinx.
We'll come back to the Sphinx and what's underneath.
Just go back to that diagram.
This one.
That's what you had published, wasn't it, Marnie? It was in your book.
No, this is okay. For the proper citation for this figure is Thomas DeBakey, Robert Schock, which is in the, you can see it in the caption. They published this figure in 1992, and I asked Robert for permission to reproduce this image in my book Under the Sphinx, and I obtained permission to do so. This paper is published, so it's accessible in the public realm. What it shows is basically the void map that they generated using seismic tomography, and the particular area that Gary is referring to is square B. That's where the head, the neck meets the shoulder. And what Gary is saying, that particular point, yes, if you connect that point to Peniston Geyser, you have a distance of a precessionally significant number, 2160 feet. Yeah. And it projects out to San Miguel.
Okay. Yeah, it goes all the way to San Miguel in the Azores. There's seven islands that are grouped together, but there's nine in total. You know, you've got two other islands that go more to the west, but yeah, it's pointed to the Azores. And as we know, I mean, I'm getting ahead of myself probably here.
Yeah. This figure, Gary, we also have to explain, this is proper housekeeping. So if you can go back real quick to Mark Lehner's figure, Joe, the one that the second Sphinx, yes, this is a figure, this is a figure from Mark Lehner, but Gary has modified this figure with these boxes A and B and the red lines and the black line. That's not part of Mark Lehner's figure. I just wanted to make sure that you understand that.
Okay.
Yeah. And you can see the distance there. I give the distance of the line there, which is those, as I said, those three processional numbers in the British Imperial measurement system. I mean, whoever devised the code cleverly used the, you know, that distance to just tell us this is no coincidence. This is intended, you know. And it's, as you can see, it's pointing to void anomaly B. So, and that's the line, that line that's being pointed from the Geyser coordinates found in the code. When you go back in the opposite direction, it goes all the way to San Miguel. I think that's the next slide, isn't it?
Yeah.
Actually, that shows you going, the one before that, that shows you the same line, the same heading line going back in the opposite direction.
Yeah.
And you can see that the Geyser coordinates found in the code are anchoring that line. It's anchoring that line. You know, giving you the positioning of it.
Okay. So you trace that back, and it goes partly through Spain, and then it ends up at the Azores. So what made you think of going to, like, tracing it to the Azores?
Well, it's just an intuitive step. I just thought, yeah, okay, you've got the Sphinx, and you know that the thing is that that line is the path of the sun on the evening of the summer solstice, and it's where the sun sets. It sets between the two pyramids. Mm-hmm. So the Giza coordinates from the code, it gives you it's not, as I said, a nondescript location. It's actually on that line of the sun setting in the west. And it sets in the Azores. And then you think, well, okay, there's a lot of belief or people speculate that the Azores location is the original Atlantis because the islands are the peaks.
Gary, isn't the length of that line of some significance that has to do with the qubit number?
Yes, it is.
I think that's what we have to say first, right, Joe? So the first answer to your question is not intuition and all that. It's factual. Again, the code is giving you a distance. The reason why it ends in San Miguel and not before or after that is because that distance is significant. It has a significant, again, numerical association with Giza, and that has to do with the qubit number. Right? I mean, Gary, is that correct? Is it 5236 something, right?
Yeah, it's 5236 kilometers. Yes.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
But that is 10 million royal qubits.
Yes.
Okay. So that in itself, again, and the other thing about the code is it keeps giving us the royal qubit length, you know, in different ways. And this is just one of them. So that, that whole distance is significant. It's 10 million royal qubits. It's 5236 kilometers. And the other thing is, and I think it might be in the next slide. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Maybe it's just going to São Miguel. It shows you São Miguel Island. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
You can see all the measurements there. And I think anybody who watches this interview will be able to see those measurements there, which is from Google Earth, all those measurements there.
So kilometers, centimeters, and feet.
Yeah. And I think, was it the feet distance is
17,178,480.
Yeah. Now, that feet distance is significant also, because I think if you times that by 2160, which is the distance between the Giza coordinates and the Sphinx, if you times that by 2160, that feet distance, then you get the number 7953, okay? And if you go to the next slide, you can see that the distance between the Giza coordinates and the Sphinx is 17953, the distance, the full distance. And that number 7953 is in the public domain, because there's a lot of textbooks from the 1800s, and I think even before that, textbooks saying that the diameter of the Earth was 7953 miles.
Okay, so there's a lot of numbers here, and I'm trying to figure out. So you're saying this is this is a kind of important number, the 7953.
Yeah, so that section of the heading line between the Giza coordinates and the Sphinx is actually 17953, the full distance, and that number is in the public domain. It was already in the public domain, so whoever devised this code has used that actual number. For that
it's because, Joe, it's because that number times the golden ratio gives you Earth's diameter in kilometer.
Yeah, that's it. That's it.
That's the significance of that number. So, okay. So see, there's a theme here, right? So we have the NASCAR line that gives you, that has a certain mile, numerical mile distance to the Giza Plateau. And that number has a significance because of the phi ratio as it relates to Earth diameter. And then here we have the same theme again. We have this ratio now, and we have a significant distance that relates to the qubit. So this is how the code talks to us. It's talking to us in headings. It's talking to us in long distances across the globe that nevertheless have numerical significances. Those significances could be expressed in any one of the three metrics so far that we've looked at. So either the meter system or the imperial system, or the Egyptian qubit system. So you collect all this style of language that the code is talking to you, and you learn the language, and then more and more becomes apparent. So I think, Gary, this is important that you point out these themes, right? So that these are not just isolated observations. This is all connected in terms of a language that the code is talking.
Yeah. It's what it is that, I've made intuitive steps, but it was all kind of concluded with these mathematical significant distances. Yeah, that you know that this is beyond just coincidence. It's not by chance. You can see it's been devised, and it's cleverly it's been devised. And what we get, what the takeaway from this is that Manu's book, where he talks about a hidden cache of records that was deposited under the Sphinx, which is being pointed to by the Giza coordinates, and by this line that when you go into the opposite direction, go straight to the Azores. As I said, it's as if it's telling us, and this is speculation, but it's just a logical answer to this, is that it's telling us that the Sphinx, the legacy is from this place in the Atlantic.
So are there any...
The cache of records may be... The cache of records that was deposited under the Sphinx, which is information may have originated in that place in the Atlantic.
So I think maybe we could move on to talking a bit about this potential Hall of Records. I don't know if there's any slides that are worth keep showing.
Well,
or
I think
we
Manu will give you that because of his book. He's got a tremendous book there. It's
sharing.
Should I do a screen share?
Yeah.
If you've got any material to hand, but I'd like to talk about that. And also, anything you have knowledge that may have happened more recently with regards to any new discoveries there. So I know that recently they've discovered some new stuff in the pyramids. So
I just want to make a point before Manu shows you what he's got there. Just to say and make it clear that this Sphinx Azores connection that's come out of the code is just one of many themes that's come out of the code. Mm-hmm. You know, it's telling us that, but it's telling us a whole lot of other things as well, which we're not even talking about today. We're just concentrating on this one aspect of the code. Mm-hmm. So
this is how, you know, Gary's and my interests are converging a little bit, because I've looked at the written evidence for an older Sphinx, and in association with that, if there was some written records that may have been kept under the Sphinx. So this is how I came at it. And then Gary recently also, you know, seeing the data pointing him to the statue. And the Sphinx is key to both the Penistone Code decipher and also to my work. So in a nutshell, to give you an idea, so I was looking for written records that predate the Old Kingdom that could give us a clue about an archive. And so what I found is not a room or a chamber that has bookshelves on it. It's not the Hall of Records, or like a library like people might imagine. But what I found is actually written references to a portable archive. So this is a box that had handles or something like that. It was carried around, and in that box was special information that was privy only to the king and his scribes. So that is actually fairly well documented in Egyptian written records. And what I'm talking about.
When you say the Old Kingdom, do you mean like First Dynasty kind of?
Third, Fourth, Fifth, and Sixth.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but you can take this back to the First Dynasty, actually. That is where most of these records are, in the First Dynasty. So we're talking at the beginning of Egyptian civilization, you know, after Narmer. Even Narmer himself, at his time, we begin to see the lioness as a symbol, as a guardian of a royal bureaucratic shrine, where basically the royal scribes were sitting and they were accounting for the king's taxes, for shipments that came to the royal household that were delivered to his future grave, and for his consumption, all of those things. So these shipments were basically sealed with this iconography of a sitting lion, and it's more significantly a lioness, actually, not a male but a female lion, sitting in front of an animal-like shrine, and that shrine is associated with the royal scribes. That iconography with time changes. It becomes more stylized as you go to the Old Kingdom, and then you see this lioness now with one bent rod sitting over her back. So when I got into this field in 2017, I thought this could be an opener. I interpreted this to be a physical object, and I thought this is a key, and which makes that lioness a building. And so I proposed this to Schock and Boval, and we wrote a paper about it. And then as research went on, I was actually able to find a potential translation. And we realized that this symbol is not an Egyptian hieroglyph, but it comes from the northern part of Egypt before it was conquered by Narmer, had some relation to Sumerian. And through that link, I was able to translate this as actual opener. So the idea that was a key and the actual translation that I found are actually very closely aligned. Anyway, so this is the written record. So there was records of an older Sphinx. And in this particular case, we think there was a lioness called Mehit. I found evidence of a portable archive. And in Under the Sphinx, the way the the whole mystery begins is actually with a piece of art that shows the heliocentric solar system. That piece of painting comes from a tomb, from a coffin. We know for a fact that the ancient Egyptians did not know that the sun is in the center, because they thought that the world is in a center and everything is rotating around Earth. Right. To them, this would have been anachronistic information. But nevertheless, there it is. We have a painting, and if there's an inscription around the painting, there's coffin texts. And when you put all of this together, you realize that this shows the sun in the center surrounded by nine planets. So there you have a paradox. And so my conclusion in the book is that this must have come from this portable archive, and that portable archive ultimately was stored in Giza sometime before Khafre. Now, for obvious reasons, I can't take this all the way back to 10,000 BC like Robert Schock did, like Graham Hancock did, like Robert Bouval. They used geological evidence, astronomical evidence, but because the written records only go back about 5,000 years. So all I can say is that the evidence that I am seeing is there was a monument before Khafre. It was a lioness. Her name was Mehit, and she guarded an archive that was not a library, but a portable ark, just like the Ark of the Covenant. And one of the items that may have been, and the type of information that I think was in this portable archive, was astronomical. It had to do with astronomy. Mm-hmm. Bouval and Hancock famously proposed, as you know, late 90s, that precession may have been this type of knowledge. They believed that the entire Giza plateau is basically a processional clock. And the Sphinx is the quintessential icon of precession, because it stares due east, one way to define precession is by looking at the constellation that rises on the equinox.
Okay.
And so that's the connection with precession. And so when Gary is saying that the code is also talking about precessional time, then that's the connection. The Sphinx is not just a key to the fine structure constant, which helps to authenticate the code, but it's also a key to precession. And the processional timeline that's encoded at the Giza Plateau. And finally, it's also the aim of the code besides the Azor. So Gary is establishing this connection between the archipelago and the statue. And so what we're beginning to wonder now is, that's where our evidence is converging, that I think there's something under the Sphinx, and Gary saying, the Peniston Code is telling us, look under the Sphinx. There's something there that we need in order to be able to solve some kind of problem. Because if we don't, then something will happen in 8100 AD that prompted the sender to send that message.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
So, and it's also referenced in the Azores as perhaps being where this, the original place where this cache may have come from. This information that's been deposited under the Sphinx. Manu, actually, in his book, he goes on to mention the cache of records were most likely breached, just before the First Dynasty, wasn't it, Manu?
Yeah, it had to be breached, because otherwise that painting wouldn't have been leaking into the funerary art of the Middle Kingdom in Al-Barsheh. You know, I have to imagine, Joe, there's a Middle Egypt we're talking something like 200-300 kilometers south of Cairo. There's a mountain cemetery, 4,000 years old. And the officials from that area, which is the city of Thoth, this is the city that was dedicated to the moon god. And in one of those tombs, you find a coffin, and that's where this painting is. Mm-hmm. We also know that the local library was called the House of Life. This is the most important library in ancient Egypt at that time, because it was obviously dedicated to Thoth. And that information must have come from that library, but ultimately that information came from Giza. And I track that in the book, the evidence for it. So that means the archive guarded by the statue must have been breached, which is what Gary was just reminding us of. And so the archive was breached, the content was moved to Middle Egypt, and then it was kept at the House of Life. And at some point, that information was leaked by the scribes, to the local high officials, and one of those was the General Zeppi, and he ended up getting this unusual painting painted onto the headboard of his coffin.
And we've also discussed, haven't we, Manu, that because of the timing of this breach, which was before the First Dynasty or the event of the First Dynasty, it's likely or it's possible that the information that was found in that archive may have kickstarted the ancient Egyptian civilization.
That's right. Potentially, yes. Because there's actually a written record, Joe. It's a bone tag. There's three symbols on it. And what the three symbols say, it says opening of the place of the Aftet. The Aftet is the word for this archive, this ark. That bone tag was found in the grave of the third king of Egypt, Horus Djer. So we're talking 2950 BC. So that is the youngest point of time that this could be referring to. So when Gary's saying, could this have been breached the opening of the archive, could that have happened at that time or before that time? We don't know. But it is striking that these bone tags were important because the king, the king's scribe, they were basically referring to certain years, not by numbers like we do, but they refer to certain years by important events that happened in the king's reign.
Okay.
That's how they marked a year. And so this particular year was marked in this way that an archive was opened.
So these events that you talk of, this breach, are these things that are in the sort of academic record or are they
Yes.
Sort of...
Yes, okay. They are. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
So these aren't refuted at all by academia in any way this symbology as well, is that something that
it's a very straightforward translation. Yeah. I have it in my book, but I'm obviously not the one who discovered this tag. This was actually found by Flinders Petrie. Mm-hmm. The references are in my book. You can easily go to Petrie's publication, look up the tag, and there are these three symbols. You can look at any Egyptian dictionary, you can translate the symbols, it's straightforward. But the archive translation, that was not so straightforward. The translation of that last symbol to mean archive, that actually comes from an Egyptologist. He's excellent. His name is Wael Sherbini. He published a book in 2017 about the coffin text, about a specific segment of the coffin text called the Book of Two Ways. And in that Book of Two Ways, this particular symbol is mentioned six times out of a total number of 17. The prior translators for the prior 100 years had a huge problem translating this particular symbol, which is the word for ark, for portable archive. Mm-hmm. But Sherbini did an amazing job, detective work. He figured it out. It's very convincing. And so I am actually referring to an Egyptologist. And so I'm not translating this on my own. I refer to an Egyptologist when I say that that symbol stands for portable archive.
Okay. And do you feel like that there is a potentially a void underneath the Sphinx and underneath the left paw that we haven't discovered, or have we recently discovered anything there of note?
Yes. So I think I actually think this is a natural cavern. According to Dobekian Shock, the void has sharp corners, has orthogonal corners, so they think it's man-made. Whichever way, I reviewed all the three experiments with I have a team of three people. We're currently looking at another way to visualize this void using satellite radar. And so we had a meeting a couple of months ago and together with a geophysicist, and we reviewed all the pre-existing data, including shocks data, seismic reflection, tomography, including electric conductivity, which was done by Stanford Research Institute in the 70s. Including gravitometry, which was done by the Japanese group, Waseda University. So we looked at all the data. And the final conclusion is that, yes, we think there is a void there. It's not just porous stone or decayed stone. There is an actual space there. But of course, you know, Joe, you know what I'm just going back to what I said in the beginning. In science, you make a testable prediction, and then you have to do the experiment. So the experiment is obviously to drill a hole and visualize to see if you're correct.
Okay.
That's how you do it.
But that hasn't been done as yet, as you know.
No, not as far as I know. No, there's a possibility that it was done and it was hidden.
Mm-hmm.
It's always possible. There is a potential area where I think it may have been done. But at the end of the day, I have no evidence for or against it at this point.
Okay.
So really, to wrap this up, is just what's going on here is that what Manu has been doing, what he's been finding, what he's been researching, you know, it's all in his book. This code that originated with a UFO UAP incident is probably the most well-documented case in UFO military history.
Yeah.
He's provided this code that actually points to the things that Manu has been working on over the last several years.
And Robert Schock and Mark Lane.
Yeah, of course.
Mean, I'm just one of many. I'm, you know, I'm at the thing, the way I'm approaching is from writing. But of course, you know, it's been looked at by many others. But yeah, but it's, you know, you stand on the shoulder of giants, and I truly stand on the shoulder of giants. You know, I had the pleasure and honor to work with Robert Schock on a few publications. You know, he's fantastic. And other researchers as well. Robert Bouval, as you know, The Astronomy of Giza with Graham Hancock, Message of the Sphinx. I mean, it's just amazing. And you look at both sides. You look at the Egyptologists themselves, Mark Lehner's publication on the Sphinx. It's an amazing read. I highly recommend it, his thesis. It's a great way to get an introduction to the fine details of the Great Sphinx.
And am I right in thinking that there's a theory that the Sphinx may have had a lion's head on top originally and may have been built at the time of Leo as per the procession? Is that?
So we have fairly convincing proof that it was a lioness, not a lion.
So yeah,
and Robert Schock is on board with that. So this is our combined paper 2017, where we concluded that this was not a male lion but a female lion, a lioness.
I thought you mentioned the second Sphinx as well. Did you earlier?
Well, so her name was Mehit.
Yeah.
Regarding a second Sphinx, we know from Arab historians that there was a Sphinx across the Nile. That is mentioned. Yes, you can look up Makrizi. He refers to prior historians that refer to a Sphinx that was dismantled, and then the blocks were used to build mosque in Cairo. So we know there was a second Sphinx across the Nile. Now, whether or not there is a Sphinx like in the Acre iconography, where you have two conjoined Sphinxes, right? Whether or not that's a real monument, so there's a second Sphinx, I don't know. There's a rock formation that belongs to the quarry from which Khafre quarried his stones for his pyramid. It's called GCF-1. That name comes from Glenn Dash, who did a survey in that area and the entire plateau. So he named this particular rock island GCF-1. That rock island looks sort of like something that you might think is a yardang from which the ancient Egyptians could have made a Sphinx. And based on that, some people have gone to Giza, they've made YouTube videos, and they're saying, look, there's the second Sphinx, okay? There's other people that have proposed there is a second Sphinx behind the Great Pyramid in the northwest corner of the Giza Plateau. I have never seen any proof of this, but there are some people that think there is a second Sphinx buried under there.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's yet another segment of the alternative historian camp that believes there's a second Sphinx behind the Khafre Pyramid. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, so I've looked at all of these things. I have never seen, Joe, I have never seen any proof that there is a second Sphinx, but that doesn't mean that there isn't one. It's just that I'm not personally aware of any second statue like that.
Yeah. In terms of going back to Atlantis and the theories that I'm sure you're fully aware of this idea of an ancient advanced civilization that may have got wiped out during a huge flood 11,000 years ago. Firstly, what your views are on that? And can you tell me if there is any more growth in the academic circles for this theory now compared to years ago when it was proposed?
Is that for Gary or for me?
For both of you. Yeah.
Gary, go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to say that what the code is showing us as well is showing us this processional timeline at Giza. And it begins at 10460 BC and ends in 2500 AD, which is in our future, of course. And so this processional timeline, and it gives us what I would think are cataclysm dates in that timeline. So when you're talking about an advanced civilization, maybe this is what all this is leading to, and it's pointing to the Azores. And of course, you know, there are theories that the Azores was the original location of Atlantis, and that the islands of the Azores are the peaks of the mountains that were submerged. You know, so you know, there's a lot of issues.
I've also heard of a theory about. Have you heard of the Rikert structure in Western Sahara?
I mean, that
is also starting to gain some momentum in terms of potential theory, and which and as well it links to Plato's ideas of what Atlantis looked like. So
yeah, there's issues.
We don't know fully, do we?
Yeah, it's speculation, and there's issues with all these locations that they think was Atlantis. I mean, even with the Azores. All I'm saying is, and I never really wanted to use the word Atlantis, the name Atlantis, because I'm just following what the code is telling us. I'm just following, you know, the area, you know, what it's saying. And it points to the Azores in several different ways. You know, it's this, what we've been talking about today with the Sphinx and that line that goes all the way to San Miguel, that's only one reference to the Azores. There's a few more that the code is giving us. So, you know, you just have to conclude that that's what they're telling us, that the Azores is important and may have something to do with this advanced civilization, lost, you know, civilization you're talking about.
Not a bad
about.
Place for a holiday as well.
No, it isn't actually. No.
you mean the Rikert structure?
The Azores.
No, but... talking about the Azores.
Yeah, the Azores, right. Yeah, I almost went to Mauritania next month. I canceled the trip, but I was going to go and visit the Rikert structure.
Okay.
It's not easy to get there, and you have to have, you need to have probably somebody from, you know, the capital going with you. I don't think you can just go on your own. It'd be safer if you take somebody with you. But
okay.
Yes.
Yeah, it's quite fascinating. If you wanted to come back and talk about that, if you ever went, it'd be interesting to...
Yeah.
To see what you think, because there's theories that it was a geological anomaly rather than being something more.
Right. The problem that this actually illustrates the Atlantis problem pretty well, the Rikert structure, because there is it is possible that the Atlantis story is just a saga. It's something that it was inspired by something that was seen, and then it somehow got back to Plato, and he created a fiction out of it. So, and if you read Graham Hancock's Magician of the Gods, he actually gets into this. So he's saying that he believes that there was a civilization back then, and it was destroyed, and you could call it Atlantis. And he's using Plato, of course, as the evidence for it, because he's the one who mentions it first. But just so you see what the problem is, you ask about the other side of the aisle. They are not on board with this because they think the whole story is invented. They think it's completely fictional.
Mm-hmm.
And so Graham mentions this also in Magicians of the Gods, that there are other researchers that have tried to first prove that Plato did not just invent the story, but that he got inspired by Egypt, Egypt's historians. And that's, of course, what we learn in Timaeus and Critias, is that Solon is the one who transmitted the story to, it came to Plato through several steps, but ultimately it came from Solon. And so the first step is, if you wanted to take up academia on this, is the first step would be to first prove that Plato did not freely invent the story, so it's not a noble lie, but that he truly got this story from Egypt. So where would you look in Egypt? And so what Graham did, he looked at the Edfu building text. I don't know if you've heard of it, but the Edfu temple is an amazing megalithic book with it's just a vast amount of text. It was written during Ptolemaic Egypt. And part of the Edfu text, there's a creation story. And when you look at interpretations from the 60s by the Egyptologist Eve Raymond, she published a book about the myth of Horus at the Edfu temple. And this is the book that Graham Hancock, and Gary knows that book. He has the book himself. Mm-hmm. And Graham used that interpretation to distill out the idea that the Atlantis story is mentioned in the Edfu creation story. And if that is the case, then of course we have proof that in fact Plato did not invent the story, but he got it from Egypt. So that's the first step. Once you once you can prove that Plato got the story truly from Egypt, then the next step is to ask, well, where is that story, that did the Egyptians refer to a real place, Atlantis? I think that's the logical sequence you have to take if you want to convince academicians, or you find archaeological relics, either in the Azores or the Rickard structure, and something that basically dates to 12,000 years ago, that you can then call Atlantean remnants. So,
I think it's fascinating that the code, this code that's from a UFO UAP incident, is assisting us in making these steps, you know, of, and I think it's timely now that, you know, that people say, oh, why did Jim Pennison sit on this code for 30 years, you know, before he came forward and mentioned these ones and zeros that he wrote down in his notebook? Why did he wait for 30 years? But then, as I said, as we was talking earlier, you know, a lot of the tools and programs and mapping programs that you would need to decipher the code properly was only made available at the end in 2018. And so him waiting 30 years before he came forward with it, it was kind of timely. Then he sent the coordinates to me, and all this information come from the coordinates. And it's taken another 12 years it's 2018, but it is 12 years since I started work on the code. And I would have needed all those programs, tools, and mapping programs to be able to decipher it properly. Yeah. And really, the thing is that it is timely, because it's only now, really, with Manu's work, and the book is published and all the information it has come to, it all connects right now. Yes. And I'm sure that
I'm flabbergasted why the UFO community is not looking at the Penniston code more seriously, Joe. I don't get it. This is way more significant than they're making this out to be. You know, they're looking at government videos and personal stories of abductions and all of that stuff, which is fine. But at the end of the day, this is the Penniston code appears to that piece to be a bridge between what they've always been interested in. They've always been interested in ancient history because they thought the aliens made the pyramids, whatever. But now they have a code that's pointing you to Giza, and that says that it's coming from another intelligence. And in this case, it's coming from the future. So that brings up a whole nother set of possible explanations for the UFO phenomenon, right? It could be simulated.
It is bizarre as well that of all the UFO incidents, Roswell gets a lot of notoriety, but Rendlesham is less known. Yeah. But actually,
I don't get it.
In terms of actual number of sightings and how long it takes, it's a far bigger case. Harder to refute.
I think there should be somebody to tell the UFO community, right, to stop being so insular. And, you know, everybody not just worrying about their own publications and books and start working together as a group and, you know, just what scholars do, right? Scholars collaborate, they bounce each other's off. But see, in the UFO community, it seems like, you know, I mean, there's absolutely no reason why what Gary is finding, it should be ignored by radio hosts, by podcasters, by discussion groups, by conferences. He should be invited to Contact in the Desert. I don't understand why he wasn't invited. You know, so this
We actually were at one time. We were invited. Me and Jim Pennison were invited, but we turned it down.
This year you're not invited, right?
Are you going to that, Manu?
Yeah, I am.
I think you were there last year. Yeah. And slightly connected to the whole the UFO community and recent events, I wondered if I could get your thoughts a little bit on this recent, well, actually it's probably about a month ago now, the Balloon Gate saga with these, the Chinese balloon and then the various anomalous sightings. What's your take on that? Is it
I watched the video,
quite prosaic, or?
I watched a video with Ryan Graves, mm-hmm. and I think his how he looks at it, his viewpoint, I think, is just spot on, really. He doesn't know what he was saying is he doesn't know what they are. And I just want to say that this code, okay, the intelligence behind it, we really don't know what that intelligence is. I can't say it's extraterrestrial. I mean, I don't really subscribe to the extraterrestrial hypothesis. You know, all we can say is that this intelligence is not restricted by the laws of our temporal spatial reality. That's all we can say, because it's predicting something that none of us could have ever known or predicted. So it's all about time. The code is a time anomaly, you know, a temporal anomaly. So when we're talking about these balloons, I'm kind of weary about the whole UFO subject and in general, really, because these incidents are happening, but we still haven't got a clue where, you know, what is behind it, or, you know, what the intelligence is behind it all. And I don't really leap on the extraterrestrial hypothesis, and neither does Jim Peniston. All we can say is we just don't know. We just don't know.
When you say that, you know, do you mean referring to the Rendlesham incident, or in general, overall, all these cases, Roswell, the 1952 incident, Virginia?
Overall. Okay. I mean, the Rendlesham incident, I mean, you know, it could have been extraterrestrial. Mm-hmm. But what the craft that Jim, the unidentified craft of unknown origin that Jim touched, that he examined, he went around and he wrote this information in his notebook. It was a drone, because he says it didn't seem it was manned or had any kind of creature piloting it. It was a drone. How do we know that, you know, in the future, it may come from the future and it was sent back into the past during an incident that they were kind of monitoring, an alien sort of extraterrestrial incident that they were just sent back into the past to monitor, to see what was going on. You see, there's all these kind of theories about it. So we just don't know. We just don't know. But this code, as I said, it's a temporal anomaly, and it's been devised by someone or something. It's more likely to be a sophisticated quantum computer in the future, you know, that's kind of created this. Okay. We talked about it, haven't we, Manu? That it could be something like that.
Yeah, regarding the balloons, Joe, my takeaway is that there is no, at this point, I don't see any effort to remove this conflation between government initiated activities and something that may be paranormal. There's this mixing between these two activities that bothers me about this field. But you never know, is this intended, is this misinformation, or is this actually a real phenomenon? On the flip side, it seems like the governments are interested in studying paranormal activities. At least they put some money into it for a while, and then when they realize that nothing comes out of it, then they abandon it. So that means that they're at least interested in it. At face value, those balloons were man-made. I don't think those are UFOs. And this is just a military, this has to do with military intelligence. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting, though, that the news media, at some point, they were talking about unidentified objects. So this is the part that where it's a little bit suspicious for me, that now all of a sudden we're starting to conflate a military a military project with something that is from the UFO realm.
Yeah,
right? Yeah. That was
the oddest thing for me, is in a world where there's a lot of potential evidence of UFOs out there being ignored by the media,
That's why.
And we're saying, why aren't you focusing on this? Then as soon as the media focuses on something, just because of the way I've been watching the whole world go for the last however many years, you kind of, the first thing I'm thinking of, the media's talking about it, so it must be prosaic. It kind of, that's like, there's right. almost like an about yeah. face between the two worlds. You know, everyone who right. was saying UFOs are just, you know, planes, birds, or whatever, suddenly they were like, oh, what is this? Whereas I was sitting there thinking, oh, it's just, it's prosaic, or it might even be all orchestrated, made up almost right. to create a narrative, which is often right. happens, a sort of false flag.
I think do you know Eric, I forget his last name, Weinstein?
Eric
or
Weinstein, yeah. I used Weinstein, to follow him right. a lot
yeah
when he was with Sam Harris and that kind of deep dark web stuff. Yeah.
He made an interesting comment. I've been watching a couple of his interviews recently, and he said something very interesting the other day in an interview. He said that we are missing the physics for the UFO phenomenon.
Yes. Yeah, it was with Joe Rogan, was it? Yeah.
He's saying we have all the physicists on the conventional side, you know, that they're discovering all these amazing things, but the UFO community hasn't come up with a physicist to actually underpin the UFO phenomenon with alternative physics theories, right? That could explain anti-gravity and appearing, disappearing, outer dimensions, right? It's missing, and he thinks this is suspicious, that this is making him suspicious that it's not a real phenomenon. Then on the flip side, he said something else that was also interesting. He's saying that there is a place in, I believe, on the East Coast, it may be New Jersey, there's a university, it's not that well known, but that is a hotbed for the world's top physicists that would be qualified to discover these kind of things. And he's saying that what you would expect...
Excuse me for a little bit.
No problem.
What he was saying is that what you would expect if this was a secret program, like these physicists are not publishing anything because it's secret research, then they should all graduate, go to a certain place where you have a lot of these people meeting, and then you never hear anything about them again because the research is secret, right? So I think he's onto something on both ends. I think he's got the right feel for the type of evidence that we need to see, you know, to something that follows up on what what's the man that was working in Area 51? I forget his name now.
Bob Lazar.
Bob Lazar, yeah. Somebody has to take the Bob Lazar account to the next level. In other words, put the physics under what Bob Lazar says he saw.
Yes.
And we don't see that. We don't see papers coming out that explain
it. It's not just the phenomenon, but there does seem to be a history going back all the way to post-Second World War of discoveries made by people that could be called free energy, could be called anti-gravity, that somehow just get quashed or put into patents and bought and then just seem to disappear. Right. And we don't seem to, unless you go and find out about this stuff, you don't know about it. You don't get taught about it in school. It's not sort of in academia at all. Yes. And it is strange why that is. And also now that these things are starting to come out, why it isn't gaining momentum. Surely there should be someone, a scientist, even if it does sound maybe conspiracy theory, like if you someone says maybe there is an anti-gravity a way of doing anti-gravity in a variety of means, and it's actually relatively straightforward, you'd think someone would want to start discovering it or be interested in it, but I don't hear the momentum within the scientific community to try and find these or even free energy. I mean, that would solve a lot of the world's problems.
On the other side, renewable energy,
you know.
That's right. Yeah. So this is if we're dealing with the real universe. But the other part of that, the flip side of the coin is simulation. That I see more weight going in that direction, because we do have a possible confluence between physics and simulation when it comes to the holographic principle, for example.
Mm-hmm.
That right hill of holographic principle says that the information that encodes our gravity experience, our spatial time experience, is actually in another place. It would be as if we are inside of a black hole.
And Hawking, the kind of the 2D space encodes.
Yeah, that's right.
3D reality.
So that, because if we are in a simulated universe, a lot of these things can be much more easily explained. including time travel, including UFOs. All of this can be explained by some kind of simulator who's basically playing tricks on us to test us. How are we reacting in a simulated universe? So when it comes, when I go to Contact in the Desert in 3 months, I am going, one of my talks is about simulating a Sphinx in the Pyramid of Unas using text and topography. So I'm not saying that, of course, I'm not saying that, you know, the Pyramid of Unas is a simulated pyramid. I'm saying is that the concept of simulation was amazingly put into practice by the ancient Egyptians, not by using zeros and ones like we see in the Matrix, but by using a special language called Heka, invocation and topography and architecture. It's brilliantly done. And mm-hmm. the goal of the presentation is to show you that the antechamber is basically an architectural representation of the Great Sphinx, including, I should add, the void where the cavern where the archive is housed. That's even that is simulated in the pyramid text.
And it makes you wonder where they got that knowledge from.
Yeah, that's right.
So is this any way connected to the kind of idea of the geometric unity, the sort of the sort of special geometry that we see encoding our world and universe? Is that connected to this Heka you were talking about? Or was that?
Well, it's actually pretty straightforward. So imagine you're in a room that has nothing in it. It's just four walls. And let's say you want to simulate a window. So you're going to take a piece of paper and write window on it and just paste it on the wall. And you're saying, I'm simulating a window where this word is written. And amazingly, to give you an example, this is what we find in the antechamber of Unas. Because if you've ever been in the Great Pyramid, when you walk into the king chamber, you are walking under this gigantic granite stone. It's huge. It's something like 6 cubits in width or 7 cubits. And as you know, there's a shaft that Robert Bouval thought was a star shaft. And so, and others before him. And so if you go now to Unas and you walk into the antechamber, there is almost exactly an exactly sized stone that is over your head. And then if you take the proportion, but there's no shaft, obviously, in the Pyramid of Unas. However, if you divide that stone into the same proportions as in the King Chamber of Khufu, where the shaft is, you find a text reference to a launch path, open a path for Unas spirit to go through. It's amazing. So this is actually a classical example of a textual topographic simulation, right? So you basically... you're not drilling an actual shaft. You're basically proportionally identifying the same spot in a different building, and then you write in that area, open a path for a canal to open up, something like that.
Sort of lends itself to the idea that consciousness is primary, and consciousness is creating the reality, and this material world is a product of the consciousness.
Exactly.
It's kind of where my mind went when you were describing that, in terms of the ability to create a shaft in the pyramid through vocabulary and thinking.
That's right.
Consciousness. Okay.
Yes.
Fascinating.
And so by the same token, there's a Sphinx there, and there's a cavern up in front of the left forepaw. This is all invocated textually, and Unas has to traverse this cavern in order to be able to go to the sky. So he's done everything that you're supposed to. He resurrected his spirit. He's unified his spirit. He's learned how to speak the language of creation. And now he's in that cavern where the primordial gods, he has to appease them. When he comes out of this cavern, he goes into the sky. That cavern is mentioned in the northeast corner of the antechamber. And the northeast corner is, in our reconstruction, where the left forepaw of the Sphinx is, where the cavern is, the void is, and where the Hall of Records is. Mm-hmm. Where the words of God, you know, in Edgar Casey's language, that is where the Akashic records are stored.
Okay.
Yeah. I just want to add that when I was talking about the Giza coordinates, so that line, that heading line from the Giza coordinates to the left forepaw of the sphinx, where the shoulder, you know, where it meets the shoulder, being anomaly B, that actually ends on a latitude that is exactly 820 royal cubits from the latitude that passes through the center of the Great Pyramid. So it's actually 820 royal cubits south of the Great Pyramid center.
Yes.
And that's significant as well, isn't it, Manu? Because that is, what is it?
The 82nd column in the sarcophagus chamber on the north wall. There's three registers. Each has 55 columns. So if you pass the first register up high, and then you go to the middle one, 27 columns. So it's 55 plus 27. That's 82. And in the middle of that column, you see a cryptic reference to the lioness with the jaw sign. But of course, we're now in the time of Unas when we have a great sphinx. At that point, the lioness was taboo, no longer mentioned. There's no reference to the great sphinx, as far as we know, no overt reference for over 1,000 years until the new kingdom. And that in and of itself is highly suspicious. But in the 82nd column, which is why that number is important, the one that Gary's mentioning, you see this reference to the line. And now if you take that web space on the left forepaw in front of the great sphinx, and you draw a line to that web space, and then you project vertically to the Great Pyramid, you have 10 times that number, 82. So this is just one of the several numerical bridges between the Pyramid of Unas and the Great Pyramid. There's several of these things, and that's one of them, the one that Gary's mentioning.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think we're running a little bit out of time. I wonder if I could ask you, both of you, a final sort of question about where you think this story is going to be going in the next, I don't know, year, 2 years, 10 years, in terms of how what role it will play in what could be disclosure.
Yeah, I think it's, this code is something that has to be accepted. You know, there's going to be a tipping point at some time that people are going to be looking into this, and then they'll find that a lot of what's going on now is already in the code. It's pointing to things. What emerged from the code is pointing to things that were happening in real time as I was deciphering it. So these times are important, what we're in right now, and this is why it's taken all this time for the code to be deciphered, which originated in 1980, it's taken all this time, because it points to things that are happening right now. And I think what Manu is engaged in with the Sphinx and the scanning of the Sphinx to find this cache, cave or I don't know, chamber underneath the Sphinx is all part of this. Yeah, it's just really, really weird that this code is pointing to things that are happening now, and it's assisting us with information. It's making these bridges between, you know, there's different kind of data sets. And and I know that Manu is associated with the code, with his work is associated with it. I think we could end, Manu, on the points that you made, that you sent to Joe. Maybe could you read some of those out? I don't know.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Well, I mean, first of all, the message to the UFO community, Joe, is to not argue with Jim Peniston, but to put the code to a test, to look at this scientifically, look at the predictions that the code is making and doing the experiment, but unify and do this all together instead of, you know, heckling and, you know, because it's a pity. This is, you know, to answer what you're saying, what you're asking for, Gary, this is probably one of the most significant pieces of evidence for an intelligence other than our own, if the code can be authenticated. That's the first thing. This is more significant than seeing lights in the sky. This is more significant than seeing some grainy video with some kind of supposed ship from another civilization out there from another galaxy. This is more significant because it's an intelligent message. The second thing is the provenance of this code. Jim Peniston, he's credentialed military man, So at surface value, at least, you should give him the benefit of doubt and not immediately assuming that he made this up, because it's highly implausible for him to create something like this. But in any case, you don't have to take his word for it. The code stands on its own feet. It's giving you all the tools to prove to you that it's real. And so people should take a look at it at least and see if Gary has discovered the way that it authenticates itself. The second mission of the code, which we haven't talked too much today about, but that is the processional timeline that it's sending, that it's appeared to be sending us to the Giza Plateau. And then the third thing is it's telling us the Azores matter, it's telling us the Sphinx matter. So what the UFO community should be doing is to come up with a way to put this code to a test in San Miguel and under the Sphinx. Mm-hmm. So my part in this is to work on providing yet another way to non-invasively see if we can prove a space in that location. And so this is what I'm currently working on. We made some progress. If something will come out of this, I might be able to publish this by the end of the year, maybe early next year. Okay. And that will tip the scale, because then we'll have a fourth modality that shows us that there's a real space there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to just add that the skeptics and pseudo-skeptics, you know, the critics against Jim Peniston, when they mention the notebook and they mention all these issues, they've all mostly been explained in the book I wrote with Jim Peniston, but they still keep coming out with all that stuff to try and discredit him and the code. Really, even if they were right about Jim Peniston, how would they explain this 12-digit number that it predicted in the future? Which is something no one could have known, could have predicted. That is a paradox that they have to get around. So all the he said, she said stuff, you know, what the with the witnesses that are trying to all discredit each other, trying to be the go-to guy on the Rendlesham incident, it's all made irrelevant by that code, how the code authenticates itself. Right. That's what they should be.
I mean, these are supposedly, the UFO community is the most out-of-the-box group of thinkers, and here they are totally in the box, coming up with, you know, all these petty little criticisms of the code when they should be looking at the big picture and, you know, looking at this scientifically, which is what our own government does. Our own government pursues paranormal phenomenon in a scientific manner. Yeah. And that's what the UFO community should be doing.
Yeah, I will say that I have noticed, certainly of late, a slight increase in the amount of, issues within the UFO community, and I think sometimes the frustrations get to people as they're sort of waiting for things to materialize and they're sort of eating each other alive a little bit, and it's a bit of a shame. Yeah. So my podcast is Up the Vibe, and it's trying to stop, if you can change your frequency and raise your vibration and look more to the future in a more positive way. So hopefully we can get beyond these petty quarrels and he said, she said moments and see that there's more to discover. It's exciting times, and it's going to be a really important future. And I don't prescribe to the doom and gloom aspects to some of the UFO community, but you never know.
Yeah, this code levels the playing field. It levels the playing field. No one person is important in the Rendlesham incident. You know, other witnesses all trying to outdo each other.
Yeah.
Jim Peniston and I mean, Jim Peniston knows this. He said it's not about any one person. Mm. It's about the code and what it's telling us. And that's what they should be concentrating on. And also trying to figure out what the intelligence is behind it. You know, who or what, you know,
is behind it. So if you were to say, what would you say is it? Is it a future human, ET, other?
Well, Jack Safadi, you know, we talked about it before in the last interview we did. I know him. I mean, you know, we go back to 1999 in communication and that. And he says his theory is that it's a post-human AI hybrid from the future.
Okay. Yeah, you mentioned that, yeah.
I agree. Yeah, I think this is an artificially intelligent quantum computer.
Yeah, I think so too. Okay.
Fair enough.
Anything else?
No, that's been, it's a good way to maybe end this now and say thank you for your time and for your amazing information, ability to recall such information, Manu and Gary. It's been great. So thank you again.
Thanks. Thank you.
Take care.
Bye.
Thank you.